Let's get in the meat and taters. The meat and potatoes of this lecture are the gradient mesh phase. Oh, this is my gradient mesh phase from Monday. And I cracked myself up with this one because somehow I created a Tom Clancy character, I think, here. This guy's name should be named Jack Reaper or something like that. Like, he just looks like the rugged, you know, superhero, super spy type to me. Not quite James Bond, but you know what I'm saying. So there's a couple of things I did to push that idea. One is the 5 o'clock shadow. You can see here, I took his hair color and made a shape of a beard and just put it in front of his face and gave it transparency. Case closed, done. You can also see that once I started down that road doing that, that it became a really good way of sort of giving it a little added layer of depth. So I did it here underneath the hair. No, that might contradict my lighting. It's okay. It gave it a little more richness. But most importantly, and don't forget, if you got smiley teeth, not in this assignment, but if you have smiley teeth, you can tone them down by creating these same shadows. Here's another one of those shadows that goes inside the white of the eye. And not only does it help to tone down the white of the eye, but you can see that I've created it in such a way that actually emphasizes the idea that the eye is three-dimensionally round. And I think the hardest thing for me to kind of accept is that everybody's eyes are perfectly round. Well, not perfectly round, but they're all round, spherical, and we just see one little side of it, which is really kind of interesting to me. So when we look at gradient mesh stuff, as you can see, I've got this example here. When we look at it in outline mode, usually one of the things that has a lot to do with the success of it is how much in outline mode it looks like a 3D model in an actual 3D program like Maya or 3D Studio Max, whatever people use these days. So there is a correlation to that, but don't be fooled. This is flat as a pancake. It has no side or back. It is flat. And don't forget that about all 2D art. All 2D art is flat as a pancake. And same with video. There's no 3D video. Video is flat. You look at a flat thing, it's flat. You may see objects moving through space, but the video is flat. So get it straight. All right. So in this one, you can see one of the things that other things I did is that I didn't try and build the entire complex image out of one piece. So in this assignment, one of the things that I want you to do is make the eye shadows, the nose shadow, the mouth shadow, shadows, any shadows in the skin, I want you to make in the one oval. But you got to be reasonable. You can't do everything that way. It makes the shape too complicated. So don't forget to, you know, we're going to do the ears separately. We're going to do the eyes separately, the eyebrows and the hair all separately. There's certain things we'll add separately afterwards to make it look better, like this shadow for the beard. So anyway, I'll show you a couple more that I did like on Wednesday. Wednesday, I got a little far afield. I was abducted clearly the evening before. No, you can see here, this is an alien. And it's got all kinds of problems. This is one of the sort of embarrassing things for me as your teachers. I never really finish these. I get to a certain point on my class over, gotta go. They're all a little bit half-baked. I need to go back and, you know, man up and fix them. But here you can see that I started making it and then it started reminding me of an alien. And with the permission of my class, I went ahead and made this an alien rather than a person. I don't want to green light everybody to do orcs and monsters and stuff. I mean, what I'm green lighting you to do is try and get some control. how you make the character posed or looking or anything like that is I'm going to be pretty open to stuff, but don't go crazy. I still need to see this kind of control over the gradient meshes. This is the same thing as the previous one. You can see that I have made these eyes out of, actually that's the eye, upper and lower eyelid. And this actually, can't click on it. There it is. That's the actual masked eyeball like we did in creating the mask. So you can see that's basically it. I don't think I got a good color on the background. I should do a better job with the background. Oh yeah, yeah, this one's pretty bad. Yeah, these are all older ones. You can see there's sort of a limitation to what you can get in terms of how, if you guys turn anything that's at least this good, I'm going to be super pleased, because that means that you got enough control over it to create the lips, nose, orbital of the eyes. The best case scenarios is that you are able to get the eyebrows and all these other parts in and make it look pretty decent. So anyway, that's what the assignment is supposed to look like. This one, of course, doesn't have a background. I want you guys to kind of complete the image. I don't want it to look half done. So before you turn it in, please do make sure to put a background of some kind in there. You know, like this one is, and these are all completed. This one does not yet have any kind of a background. Just, I don't care what it is, color, or you put stuff back there. That's fine. So you ready? I'm going to make a new doc. A new print doc, 8.5 by 11. There it is. Woo. Now, we've been through this gradient mesh tool a little bit already, and so I'm not going to re-explain that we've got object create gradient mesh and that we've got the mesh tool and that they function differently. The gradient mesh functions automatically, creates a grid of rows and columns, and the gradient mesh tool adds rows and columns by pointing and clicking. I'm not going to re-explain that. Okay, wait, maybe I already did. I'm going to grab the ellipse tool and I'm just going to make an ellipse. Okay, and this is going to be the whole face. I'm making it nice and big so I can be comfortably working on it. And I'm going to give it, you know, starting out with I'm going to go with a more rich skin color here. I'm adding a little bit of cyan and black to it to give it a little more richness. And once I get her out the right color that I want, I'm going to get a little square over here. I don't want a stroke on that. And I'm going to make little copy drag swatches. These are exactly swatches. I could use the swatch palette. I could take these colors and drag and drop them into an empty spot in the swatch palette here. If you grab one of these and you drag and drop it right there, it will add, well, I've added it up here, adds a swatch to your swatch library. So you can do it that way. You can make these little ones out to the side. I just don't like to, I don't like the swatch palette. I don't like to get in there too often. So I'm going to do it this way. So I'm going to click on the top one. And I'm going to make it my highlight color. Basically going to take the complexity out of it. And in Photoshop, don't forget, in Illustrator, don't forget, you can hold down the shift key and press and drag to saturate certain colors. So I did that with that one. That's my highlight color. And this is going to be my shadow. I'm going to saturate it a little bit by holding down the shift key and dragging any one of the sliders, and it moves them all proportionately together. I'm going to do that. Did that a little bit. And then I'm going to add a little bit of black. So I'm going to click, let go of the shift key, click on the black. And for starters, that's my shadow color. I said for starters. I think that once you start putting them in there, you might decide that that's not dark enough and that you need actually a darker color in there. I think that's going to be the case here. I'm going to go ahead and add a little more black to it. And maybe shift a little more. I want a little more dramatic color between my different levels. So I probably should desaturate this one a little bit more, holding down the shift key. So now I got more depth between the colors. Okay. Now, we talked a little bit about before about a couple of things. One thing to remember is once I make this oval a gradient mesh, it's always going to be a gradient mesh. You can't turn it back into a regular polygon. You can delete all the gradient mesh points, but it remains a gradient mesh object. How do I know? Because a gradient mesh object will not hold a stroke. So once you click with the gradient mesh tool or use object, create gradient mesh, it's a mesh object unless you hit undo or something. excuse me. Coffee. I love coffee. Coffee's my thing, man. All right. So I want to put a shadow to start in the orbital of each eye. And the thing that I'm going to help me do that is I'm going to go under the view menu and choose show rulers under the view menu. And the reason I'm going to do that is so I can pull from the top ruler. If you go in the middle of the ruler and press and drag down, you get a guide. And you can even grab one from the left ruler and bring it over and get another guide. And you can see I got these guides now telling me where dead center in my sphere is. And that's important to me because you may already know your eyes are at the halfway point on your cranium. People are like, no, they're not. They're higher than that. No. They're not higher than that. Your eyes are in the middle of your head. Anyway, I'm going to go under view to guides and I'm going to choose, the guides are already locked. I just wanted to make sure these guides were locked and they are. And if I click on my object, you can see where halfway is. Now, the gradient mesh tool is over here in the toolbar and it is activated with the letter U on the keyboard. And when you click on the gradient mesh tool and you move over an object, you can see it has the plus add gradient mesh. And if I click on the swatch color and click in the middle of my object, you can see that it takes the don't do that yourself. This is just showing you. If you click there, it sends the shadow all the way to the edges. And this creates a problem because the color is going too far. I don't want the color going all the way out to the edges. I want to stay in the middle of the opening of the eye. So what I have to do before I start adding color is I need to identify where the center of the eye is with a click of the gradient mesh tool on the regular color that the median skin tone is. So I'm going to do that now. I'm going to go to where I want the middle of the eye. Right about here, I'm going to just click once. It's going to be a little below dead center, and that creates a gradient mesh there. Now I'm going to do that. I want one on the exact same space on the other side. So I'm going to move this distance times two right about here and put the other eye right here. And when I do, I get those series of points. Now, I don't want to give them the shadow color yet because it'll just go up the whole half of the thing. So what I need to do is I need to install a series of confining meshes. And what the confining anchor points do is they keep the color in. We talked about this a little bit when we did the clouds in the sky in that one exercise last week. So I've got the center and now I want above it to stop. How far do I want the shadow to go before it stops? And I'm going to click once on a vertical. And when I click on a vertical, it just makes a horizontal. If I don't, I get two really close together. See how that is right there? Don't do that. That's like really going to be a problem. Because if you click on the anchor point to the left of it and give it a color, it's only going to go that far over to the next one over. So be careful before you do that. Anything that close together, that needs to be a very narrow whatever it is. And here I want an open area like this orbital of the eye. So I don't want to put that too close. So I'm going to make sure that I clicked right on the vertical line that creates only a horizontal. So this is my eye shadow, and that's above the eye shadow. I need to click once on the vertical below the eye shadow. And this is how far down the shadow in the orbital of the eye is going to travel. Okay. Now I have the center of the eyes, but what I need is the inside of the nose and the outside of the temple for each side. So I'm going to go to the middle anchor point here, and I'm going to define the bridge of the nose by clicking an anchor point on this horizontal line once on either side of the exact center. And it's not letting me do that because the anchor point is right there. So I'm going to click in the middle there so it selects everything. And now I can click on this one here because the anchor point isn't there. So now I just defined the space in between the two eye sockets, the bridge of the nose. Now I'm going to define the temples out here of the eye socket. So I'm going to go same horizontal. I just want to add a vertical. I've already got the horizontals I need. And I'm going to click here to create the outside of the stage right eye and here to create the stage left temple. And now I'm set up for my color. So I told you before that you always want to be aware of what move tool you had selected last, because if you hold down the command key, it's going to change the gradient mesh tool into whichever of the move tools that I've, or the selection tools that I've selected last. So I'm going to make sure that I selected the direct selection tool last. So I'm going to click on the direct selection tool, and then I'm going to click on the gradient mesh tool. And what that means is when I hold down the control key, it's going to go from the gradient mesh tool to the direct selection tool. And what that does is allow me to switch from making a mesh point to selecting a mesh point, because I got to select this mesh point to change its color. So if I select this mesh point and this mesh point, you can see that's what color they are. I can actually drag this color right over that. I lied. So what I'm going to have to do is select these both, and then I'm going to hit I on my keyboard to get the eyedropper and then go boink. Oops. What happened? I did the wrong ones. I mean, undo that. Plus I have the wrong anchor point selected. This is the anchor point I want. Oh, wait. Sorry. What's happening here? I'm missing one right out here. There we go. Okay, so I'm going to click on these two anchor points. I got the eyedropper. Huh. See how it's not changing the color? Oh, there you go. I'm not sure what that was all about. Okay, so if I'm going to go under view and I'm going to hide the guides. There we go. Now I can see what I'm doing better. Okay, so I can see. Yeah, okay, well, so what? You put shadows in there. Doesn't look all that good. And I would agree. I look at some of these and I'm like, yeah, it's not quite dark enough in there. I am going to add much more black to that shadow area to darken it up. And I'm going to do that same thing we did with when we made the clouds, which is I'm going from command key. I've got the eyedropper. When I hit the command key, I get the last of the selection tools I selected, which was the direct selection tool. And what this allows me to do is go from the eyedropper to clicking on a handle and pulling the handle back. So I'm going to pull the temple handles back so that they, let the inside color go further towards them. And I'm going to do the same thing with the top of the eyebrow. I'm going to move those mesh tools up so more of the shadow color can go up there. And similarly down here, on the cheek, I'm going to move these handles down to let more of the color go on the cheek. Now, when I do that, I'm also going to create, if you recall, the more you pull the handles across each other, in this case, with the gradients, it can create an edge on the gradient, not a nice smooth transition, but a harsh transition. So if I grab one of the inside anchor points from the center anchor point, or one of the inside handles from the center anchor point, and pull it beyond the handle of the adjacent one, you see it starts to get a little bit of an edge. And if I take this one and pull it beyond and then push this one some more, you can see I start to get an edge there. And it's different for every color combination, how far you have to pull these handles out to get them. You can do that, but you can see that it's creating an edge for me. The other thing I can do is do the same thing on the outside. So I'm gonna pull my handles almost to the far outside. One of the tricky things here is you kind of got to do the same thing to both sides. So whatever you do to one side, you're kind of obligated to do it to the other side. Let's see where my handles are. Oh, right about here. And this one, whoops. This one goes right about, I see it over here. Nope, that's too much. So I have to play this little game between these two handles to get the edge of the eyes where I want it. And you can see I got it pretty close here. Here it's a little further away. So I'm going to nudge it some more to try and pull it in. There we go. So now I've got these sort of overdriven handles. And I'm going to do the same thing to the eyebrow. The eyebrow is usually a border, so I'm going to pull the handles up beyond the anchor point, even beyond the handle, even beyond the anchor point of the top. You can see that creates more of a ridge here. If you zoom in, there's still a bit of a blend there, but you can see that I'm able to create edges with these. And so that helps me with the orbital of the eye. Now, here's the thing that's different than some of the things we've been doing before with this. And that is the idea of managing these anchor points, not by clicking and dragging and moving the handles, but check this out. I'm gonna grab the inside anchor points of both bridge of the nose is on the inside. Okay, I got these anchor points all selected. You know, you get your direct selection tool, hold down the shift key and click on them individually. Or in the case, the way I did it was I went to outline mode and I just pressed and dragged around them so I could select them. When you're in outline mode, you can click where there's a fill and it won't select the fill. If I'm in preview mode and I do that, I just move something. Okay, so you go to outline mode, then you can select anchor points by just pressing and dragging to go around them. And that's something I'm going to use a lot here today. So I just did that. Now check this part out. Rather than moving them by hand, I'm going to get the scale tool. I'm going to get the scale tool and I'm going to press and drag, holding down the shift key now to make it go straight down. I'm going to press and drag straight down. And when I do, you can see that I can pinch the eyes. I do that. See how I just pinched the eyes? So I made the insides of the brow come down a little bit. That was maybe too much. I'm going to go back a little bit more, lift that up a bit. But I can do the same thing with the outside. I can grab the outside anchor points here through the outline mode and then look at them in preview and get the scale tool and hold down the shift key and press and drag. And you can see that I can manipulate the way the temples shadows are going. And I'm not really sure how I wanna manipulate those. There you go, somewhere around like that. Now, here's the other cool thing. Okay, Chip. Well, if I did it with the scale tool, couldn't I just select the whole eye side and rotate it? Oh, well, why, yes, you can. So here I go. I'm going to use the outline mode again with my direct selection tool. And I'm going to select the whole stage right eye. And I'm going to get the rotate tool. Here I am. Where are you, rotate tool? Here you are. I'm going to need these tools today. And I'm going to, once I have the rotate tool selected, I'm actually going to click on the orbital of the eye so that doesn't change the position, but it stays the same, the center of the orbital of the eye. And now I'm going to just rotate it a little bit. And you can see I can vary how the angle of the brow, you know, to kind of in where maybe it looks a little more concentrated or demure, maybe. I don't know how you would want to describe that. I'm going to do the other side here, and I'm going to select all that side too. Now, I already made a rotation on the right side. So for this to look right, I need to make the same rotation on the left side. So this is where I'm going to double click on the rotate tool. And you can see it makes the same by default. It remembers the last time it rotated. So that's what's in the value here. But it rotated to the same direction. And the problem is with the other side of the eye, I have to rotate it the opposite direction. So I'm just going to select before 16.93 degrees and type in minus. If I hit the tab key, then it rotates it. And now you can see that both sides are rotated the same amount. Yeah, I think that's too much, honestly. I'm going to cancel that and undo this one. And I'm going to rotate it slightly less. There we go. More like that. Now I'm going to try the other side. You know, the great thing is, you know, you try something, and if you like it, you keep it. And if you don't, you do it again. I'm going to do the same thing. I'm going to option click on the orbital of the eye. It comes up with the same degrees. This time it's half as many, 8 instead of 16. And I'm just going to type in -8. And you can see it gives me the same rotation now on both sides. So now my eyes are just slightly higher on the outside than on the inside. So, all right, how am I doing? Check. I guess it would probably be a good idea for me to do a save as at this point. And I'm being sarcastic when I say it that way, because like a doll, yeah, you should have done that by now. So I always like to live dangerously, but not that dangerously. I am going to my week 12 folder, and I'm going to name this something I haven't already before. How about 1201C? Hopefully that'll fly. It is PDF format that I'm looking for. Did you guys notice that I clicked on a pre-existing PDF and it automatically in this Mac renamed my save as? And I think that works in a PC too. I have to go over here and check. But and then I just changed the version number A, B to C. Anyway, I'm saving it in my week 12 folder and hit save. And do, if you can, save it as the Illustrator default. That seems to be one of the more safe things to do. I'm going to go ahead and hit save PDF. And if I look at my outline now, I can see, okay, I'm moving towards that. Looks like a 3D wire mesh thing. Now for the tip of the nose. So the tip of the nose is created in this tutorial by creating a confining mesh at the top of the tip of the nose, a shadow anchor point in the between the septum and the upper mandible, and a stop gradient mesh just above the lip. Okay, so when I make these next three gradient mesh clicks, the top one I make is going to be the tip of the nose, then the back of the nose, then the top of the lip. So I am going to actually make the nose, and I'm going to put all the features kind of up high on the face. I'm going to make the nose short, not long. If you look at my previous ones, the nose, I'm striving for some sort of anatomical ambiguity in the proportions. But this one, I'm going to stretch that a little bit. I'm going to move the nose up a little higher. So I'm going to click right here. That's going to be the tip of my nose. This is going to be the shadow underneath the septum, and this is going to be the top of the lip. All right, so with the nose, you don't want it to be too narrow at this stage. And the same things I did to the eyes, I can do to the nose. Like I can select the whole nose and rotate it or scale it in vertical and horizontally or both. And I'm going to do the same thing here. But first, I got to give it the color. And I'm going to start out by clicking right here and using my eyedropper to pick the shadow color up from the orbital of the eye. And when I do that, it's a little darker than I wanted it to be. So I can always click further down the gradient. Anywhere you click on the gradient with the, when a gradient mesh is selected, anywhere you click with the eyedropper, it's going to pick up that exact color. All right, so it did all that, but you can see it's way too narrow. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to select both, hold down Command to get the selection tool and Shift so I can add to the selection I already have, and pressing and dragging in outline mode. And now I'm going back to preview. And I'm going to get the scale tool. There you go, scale tool. Come on out to play. There we go. There's the scale tool. So I got the scale tool, and I'm just going to press and drag in the center here, and I can broaden the nose by doing that. Now, when I did that, do you see how much it distorted the handles? If you look over here now, the handles are like, wah, whoa, that's a problem. I don't want to do that. There's other ways I can make the nose broader besides doing that. So I am going to use the same scale tool. And I'm going to pull this back at least that far. So the handles, golly. So the handles don't overlap each other so much. And, you know, one of the other things I might consider doing, honestly, is adding, I'm going to go to outline mode. It was outline mode. I'm going to hold down the command to get the move tool and shift to add to the selection. And then grab these outer cheeks. That's more than one way to keep these points from overlapping each other. So I'm grabbing now these, and these. And I'm going to use the scale tool and pull that out broader. You see the nose got broader. Oopsie, I did the same thing way out here. So I need to do it a little bit at a time. I'm going to pull that out a little more. And at this point, I think what I need to do is just move these by hand. I'm going to try and give it a little more point. Now, when I moved that one side by hand, I know I need to move these the same amount in the opposite direction. So you remember how when I did the rotate on the one side and I went, I need the same thing on the other side, but then I needed the same minus. I'm going to do that same thing here through the object transform move command. So the move command also remembers the last move you made. And here it's given me horizontal, vertical, and an angle. And I need to reverse what's plus and minus. So I'm going to hit minus here and hit the tab key so I can. Okay, so that did that. But I also need to minus these. I'm going to undo it. So there we go. Okay, so this needs to be minus and this needs to be plus. Nope, that was it. I have it where I should, I believe. Anyway, it's close. Look at the, is it bilateral symmetry? Is that, and it's close enough. I'm going to click okay. So now the center anchor points handles are not very dynamic. So I'm going to select just those center anchor points. And again, I'm going to use the scale tool to draw those out and pull the shadow of the nose out further. And once I get all that happiness done, I can also go back in here and correct some of the points. I talked to a student yesterday and showed her this, and she went, wait a minute. You mean you can change the anchor points and the handles after you draw them? And I was like, yes. All right. So don't forget, it's very important. It makes it much easier to work on. So I'm going to pull these handles down to bring the shadow from the septum down further. I'm trying to keep this a little bit straight. And I grab this, and I can pull the handle down to bring the color down. Here at the tip of the nose, maybe I pull it up too far, not that far, maybe a little far. And that gives me the shadow, the end of the nose. And here I'm going to pull these handles out to allow the shadow color to push those handles back in, I should say, to allow these color to go further out. And I'm going to grab these and this. You see I'm pulling those handles out. You can see the darker color going out and around. Of course, the problem is that that really makes me wonder, you know, sort of, shouldn't I put something here to connect the nostrils with? And the problem is if I put shadow here, it's going to go all the way out to here. And I would want it to stay like right in here. So, you know, I could try, you know, adding another anchor point here and here. Let me go ahead and do that. So I'm going to get my, mesh tool, and I'm going to click right on the horizontal so I don't get too close together. And then I'm just going to try and see how making these two anchor points, the shadow color reacts. And when I pick that up, yeah, it helped them be broader. But if I go up into here and try and include this anchor point and this anchor point, use my eyedropper here. Actually, that worked really, really well for me. How lucky I am. How lucky am I? Well, I'm about that lucky anyway, that worked out as well as it did. As a matter of fact, I'm going to go with that. I'm going to grab these two anchor points here, and I'm going to pick up that anchor point from there. And now I'm starting to work a pretty nice side shadow here. As a matter of fact, I'm going for it. I'm inspired now. I'm going all the way up the bridge of the, oops, maybe not that far just yet. I'll get back to that. But yeah, that nose came out better than I usually get. The other thing I can do too is we have not yet worked with a highlight color. Bridge of the nose is usually a good place to do that. So I'm going to select that center anchor point, use my eyedropper, pick up the shadow or the highlight color, and you can see that subdues some of that color pretty well. I'm gonna pick up some slightly lighter. I gotta really not put anything in this row here until I got the eyebrows done. So since I'm working on the nose, I'm gonna go ahead and make some eyebrow shapes. I'm gonna use my gradient mesh tool, and I'm gonna okay, so this is where the eye is. So this would be the eyebrow highlight, let's call it. And this would keep the eyebrow highlight from going too far up. So that means I can click on these two anchor points here and use the eyedropper to pick up some highlight color there for the eyebrows, which starts giving me a highlight as well as a shadow, better blends. I'm going up here and picking up the highlight color as it goes up the bridge of the nose. And the other thing I can do above that, just keep going, is I'm going to add, oops, yipes, get my median color here. I'm going to add a couple anchor points here. And you'll see momentarily, I made two groups of three. I'm going to select, okay, so wait a minute. So these, and then skip a row and go these. I think I made more than I thought I made. Then these. Oops. It's hard to select these anchor points. That's why I do it in this way. Now, when I use my eyedropper, I can pick up shadow colors in there and get like furrow brow. I think I have too many of them. And this brings up a really important point, which is you can delete a mesh. New delete a mesh from Ronco. So I'm going to select the segment of one of these meshes and hit delete. Did it go? Forget, you have to select the anchor points, but not the exterior ones, I believe. So I'm going to select these and hit delete. Well, there's more than one way. There we go. The old trusty undo button. Okay, so one, two. Okay, so it starts here. Wait, it starts here. One. Two, okay, I see what I did. Let me redo that. So now I have one. Oops. I'm going to have to do these one at a time because it's getting really complicated in there. I have rows that I want to keep and rows that I want to get rid of. So I just got to be careful what I have selected. Okay. There's one. Here comes the other. Not as much. So those are a little low down. I can grab all of those and use my arrow key to soften that effect by moving them up. You can see it's kind of overemphasizing the brow there. So I can just take these handles and pull them up higher and let that color go further up. And that way the shadow is a little more under control. And I'm getting some contour in there. All right. So far, so good. I'm going to hit save again. Are you guys following me? You dig it? Can you dig it? You know, what I want from you guys is to be fearless with this. I want you to try and get control over it. And don't stress out about the outcome too much, especially if you're previously really good at this stuff and you've never done this and it ends up, you're like, oh my God. Don't worry about it. Just, I want you to get in here and try and do this. It's not as, I don't know if what your perceptions of how hard this is or not, but it is the culmination of everything from the trace over. You know, the trace over is all about, you know, the handles and anchor points and like controlling them specifically. And truly with the gradient mesh, it's really hard to get that much out of it if you're not messing with the meshes and controlling the anchor points and their handles. So you really can't do this gradient mesh stuff that well until you've really got some experience with the pen tool. So that's why it's week 12. So I'm ready to make the mouth, and I'm going to make the top, an anchor, a mesh point for the top of the lip, the middle of the lip, and the lower lip. Now I'm going to make that slightly redder than the skin tone, but here's the other thing. I'm going to make it redder first, and then I'm going to add two more mesh points to make a shadow in between the lips, and you have to do it in this order. You can't make the shadow and then add the outside ones as easily as you can do it the way I'm going to show you. So here we go, and this is in the other lectures as well. Get a little bit of a wonky point here, so I am going to straighten that back out again. So I'm working with easy enough stuff. I'm going to get U on my keyboard, gets me the add mesh tool. And I'm going to actually, this anchor point here could be the top of the lip, but I want a little space between the lip and the shadow. So I'm going to move a little bit farther down. This is the top of the lip. This is the middle of the lip, and this is the bottom of the lip. I'm going to undo that twice and make the top lip slightly narrower than I had it. And then the lower lip was about right. So remember, the only one of these anchor points that gets color is the one in dead center. Okay, that's the one that gets the color. So it's going to push the color out to the edges. And my job is to go back in and move the handles so the color can get to the edges. Also to manipulate the handles of this center anchor point, which has the color in it. So for the color, and do remember this, it's true always. no matter what race, if you're doing like an African-American person or something like that, it's still skin tone plus magenta. So because what it is that your lips are full of veins and nerves, as you may, anybody who's cut a lip knows. But if you, you know, it's pink because the capillaries of the skin are so close to the surface. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take advantage of that by just adding magenta to the median skin tone. And that's not all. You have to do more than that. You know, it's so I'm adding, you know, bunch of more complicated colors. My character feels male to me, so I'm going to be careful about not making the lips too red or pink. You know, not that, you know, you can't have red or pink lips, but usually, you know, with the skin tone I have, the person's lips are going to be a little bit darker than that. So I'm adding the magenta, but I'm also adding some more cyan and black. Now I'm just going to sort of saturate that. It's interesting. The color I've got, there's really kind of more of a brown, burgundy, I don't know. All right. Now, the thing I need to do now is I need to make this look like a mouth. And one of the ways I'm going to do that is I'm going to select all the corner anchor points on both sides, and I'm going to use the scale tool to squeeze them together so that the corners of the lips go together. So to do that, I'm going to go to outline mode. And I'm just going to select these anchor points, which is easier for me than clicking directly on them. Sometimes you can get two in one swipe like that. And then I'm going to use the scale tool and do it this way. And I'm going to press and drag, and you can see them coming together. And this is actually a better way because I can see how close they're getting, about to there. You can see these didn't quite make it there. And then he's going, you bow mouth. So I'm not sure this is all how I want it. Also, this center anchor point that, how do we do that? So this is a good way to sort of calculate that. The other thing, and I'm going to get in here now, and I'm going to go straight across. I don't want this one. And I've got all of the mouth anchor points, and I'm going to use the arrow key to nudge that down. And then I'm going to get my scale tool and press and drag. See what it's doing to these anchor points? That could be a that could come back to bite me. So I'm going to undo that and grab them. One of the ways to get away from these anchor points crossing over each other is to include them in my selection. Now they got anchor points adjacent to them that can be a problem, but let me see how far I can scale this before they start conflicting with each other. So probably right about here. And then I'm probably just going to go ahead and grab these remaining anchor points on the outside and scale it some more. And I can kind of keep an eye on the sides. Missed one right there. Now I can kind of keep an eye on the size and how much the handles are getting distorted around the edge there, as you can see. You see how my mouth is doing? It's doing better. So I'm going to grab actually all of these anchor points that are to the corner of the mouth, these three right here, and I'm going to use the object path. Oops. Got the wrong tool selected. I'm going to get my direct selection tool selected. And do object path. Oh, it should be average. Why is it not letting me average that? Hold on. Got the direct selection tool. Select all three of these. Object path. I guess you can't average meshes. I was going to try and take these anchor points and make them all in the same spot, but I'm going to have to do it the old fashioned way. Fine. Be that way. There you go. Chew on that. There we go. I know this does cause me to mumble to myself. Mumble or grumble? I'm not sure which. So now I've got the corners of the mouth all tied down pretty well. And I'm going to go ahead and start manipulating the interior handles here to try and get a better grip on how the lip is blending between the anchor points. I'm going to let it fade more on the sides. I am going to push the horizontal meshes into the corners so the color goes to the corners. Now you can see that's fine, but it looks very flat, okay? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to put a shadow in the middle. Now it's important that I did it in this order because what I've already done is established the mouth in terms of you know, how much, what color is going to blend from the center out. Now what I'm going to do is add two more meshes, one above and one below the middle of the mouth. And now I can click on the middle of the mouth and add more black. And that creates a shadow between the lips. Now I need to be careful about how much room I give it to blend. Like here you can see I'm sort of working with the upper lip a little bit there. And I'm going to grab the lower lip as well, these two anchor points here. Ooh, doggy. Come on, what's going on here? Oops, yipe. There we go. Give him a side lip. Give him an Elvis lip. Come on, mama. Nobody thought that was funny? All right. I'll save my stand-up act for the evenings. Okay, so I've got the mouth, and you know, I'm looking at my proportions and everything, and I'm just thinking, well, now the nose maybe looks too broad. And this is the important thing about this point in my production is that I'm doing that, you know, remember we talked about process, assemble, assess, how's it look? And if it doesn't look great, revise, and then assess again, and then revise again. And then once you get it all straightened out, move on. So here I'm looking at the nose and I'm going like, no, it's a little broader than I wanted it. So, you know, it changes as you add the different parts. So I'm going to go ahead and narrow the nose a little bit, and it's looking a little out of place. I think I need to sort of click on these two anchor points. And again, I'm using the scale tool here. Once I select the anchor points, to pull those out. And when I pull those anchor points out, you can see what it's sort of doing, some good, some not so good. I think this color here looks like it's lacking in magenta. So I'm gonna pump that up a little bit. Give it a little more magenta in the highlight. It was looking a little pale. Same thing here. A little color in the tip of the nose now. And here I am going to use the eyedropper, pick some color up there. Okay, so I'm getting pretty close now, and I can still move these features around. Like I can I didn't mean to do that. Oops. So what I'm gonna do now is move the mouth. I'm still struggling with the position of the mouth and all that stuff. So I'm grabbing the mouth and sort of making sure to deselect anything I accidentally got from the nose. I'm checking it out and sort of pulling that down a little bit farther. That's better. the other thing I can do, and this is an important part, is I can, you know, if these, you know, when I get the gradient mesh tool and I've got these meshes and they're giving me a hard time, one thing I can do is disable their handles. So if I get the anchor point tool from the pen tool palette, see these handles that are pushing too hard? I can just click on those, pretty sure, and redo their handles so that they're not so big. So if I make all the handles on these small, then when I go to move the mouth wider, it's not going to overlap the handles that these guys are producing. So that's one way I can mitigate what's going on in terms of how the handles are affecting each other. You can see these are too long. So I'm just making these handles smaller, and pulling them out. And I can do this, if I'm gonna do that over there, then I'd do the same thing over here. Let me do select all these. And you can see how far the handles are going. So I'm just gonna press and drag with the handle tool. I'm trying to figure out which way it's going. So these I'm having to do by hand. And yeah, nobody said it was going to be easy or simple to do. Here's my handles here. And here. Yipes. So what that means, and now this time I'm going to try doing it from the center. I guess it doesn't matter. Let me try it now. Oh, see, I still got the ones on the bottom here. So with the convert tool, I'm just going to disable those, if you will. Let me disable this one. Okay, so now I should be able to select the mouth. There we go. Got all the parts in the mouth except for this bottom lip. And now I'm going to use the scale tool. And now I can have much more leeway. And you can see the corners of my mouth aren't getting too messed up. And I'm not screwing up these because these are going to come into play later when I start doing shadows on the outside, which I'm almost at. Okay, so fit and window. Yeah, mouth is even a little broad now. I mean, like, oh, make up your mind. So, you know, if I'm showing you anything, I'm showing don't go, oh, good enough, fix it. And part of what we're doing here is learning how to fix things. So I just grabbed all that. Now I'm just going to use the scale tool and just bring it in a little bit better. There we go. That's a little better. Okay, so now I'm going to make a highlight on the tip of the chin, much like on the nose here. I want to connect the face. So get my my gradient mesh tool. I'm going to add a mesh right about where I would, where I would see that highlight color to be. Here it is right here. Actually, I don't want that color. I just want to make a mesh for it. I'll add the color after I put the confining meshes in. So this is going to be the shadow under the lip, the end of that shadow. And then this is going to be a highlight and this is going to be the end of the highlight. Oh, you can see how it's really messed up my anchor points here. Some of what I've done. I grab this and pull it down. You know, that helped a little bit. So this is going to be the shadow underneath the upper lip. So I'm going to grab a shadow color from the upper lip. Notice I'm not going for full out. That's too dark. I'm going for a light shadow color there. And my first inclination is to grab the bottom parts of it here and use the scale tool to pull those out, which did not work well for me. Let me try that again. I'll hold this one in on it. Try it again. That's a little better, but looks like you got some ice cream cone on his chin there. I don't know. Take that down a little bit. So I just took some of the black out of it. I'm sort of letting it go closer to the skin tone. There we go. A lot of times the shadow's not wrong. A lot of times the shadow's just too dark. So you can see here I'm messing a little bit with how dark things are. All right, so there I've got it. Now the tip of the chin right here, I'm gonna go ahead and pick up the highlight color from here. So there's that. I really don't like how it's moving here. If I grab these two anchor points and give them that highlight color, I need to, there's something that's really messed up here. This one and this one are messed up. Yeah, and these look like ones I'm gonna have to move individually. You can see how they pull the color way up there. I don't know if you can see what's going on there, but I'm going to basically bail out on those. So I'm going to select both of these and I'm going to return them to the color they were. Actually, yeah, I'm just going to pick the regular color. All right, okay, so now I'm going to, oops, yeah, I did the wrong thing. There we go. So I am going to have to move these out. It's driving me crazy. So I'm going to grab these anchor points here. Go to outline mode. Now I'm going to use the scale tool. Oops. It's not having the effect I want. I have the wrong thing selected. There's a whole bunch of them up there. They're all tangled up. So I'm going to leave that for now. I'm going to go ahead and finish the rest of my shading. Now, at this point, I'm going to grab Let me go up here. I'm going to add a couple of mesh points to keep the shadows. I'm going to add one right on the zygote arch right here on the side of the head, and one over here. It's going to keep the highlight color. And now I'm going to select all the anchor points all the way around the bottom half of the face. So that means I'm going to have to get in here. You see, I've got all those selected up here. Oops. Holding down my shift key and surrounding these anchor points to add them to my selection. It's super tedious and very detailed. And you have to be zoomed in enough. You can't do this if you're not of the proper magnification. Now here across the bottom is easy to do. I can just grab all those. It's really just going up the side that gets tricky. You know, you can see I'm grabbing them in a couple at a time. I've got the shift key down, so I'm adding to the selection. And now I'm just, here's where it's really the worst. Go. Coming around the mountain. Here we go. In window view. Okay. Now I'm ready to add the shadow that is on the edge of the chin. So here's the eyedropper tool. Give me it. There we go. Now I'll be able to tell if I missed anywhere or if I have overdriven edges. So here is where I see the overdrive of my edges. And gosh, I wish I could remember how to delete an anchor point. I'm pretty sure. Yeah, I know you can delete an anchor, delete rows and columns. I'm just not very good at doing it. Now, as I look at the corners of the face, especially right here, I can see that I have this problem again of the handles of the anchor points overdriving each other because I use the scale to move them. So that should tell you that that scale technique and the rotate technique of manipulating the gradient meshes. And you can do it with handles as well, just regular anchor points as well, is all well and good, but it does cause certain problems. So I'm moving these. Oops, I got one extra one I didn't need there. So I'm 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I'm counting them because I'm going to do the same thing here. I'm using the arrow keys. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And I think that helped. But these are all twirled now. So I need to go in and get my convert direction tool and reset these, I believe. Yeah. Sadly, this is going to take me some time to do both sides. So I have to sit here and pull these out so now that it'll gradate properly to the from one edge to the other. It's not the end of the world, but I'd prefer not have to do this. And then, you know, theoretically, I should be able to move this row of anchor points, and that should soften the blend so the blend is not going so quickly. That's part of what my issue is here. So I'm going to select these anchor points and then use the arrow keys. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And that gave me a better edge. Looks like I lost some color right here. I'm just going to pick it up. Same thing with this one. It's got the wrong color. So I'm going to pick up that shadow. So that wasn't too bad. I might want to click on this one and add the shadow color in there. Although that's giving me too much of a line, so I'm going to undo it. And you can see I got the same issue over here. So I'm going to try doing it a different way. Maybe I'll grab these anchor points this time. Although I don't think that's actually the problem, is not so much these as that the other one's handles are all twisted. So I'm selecting these by hand. Oops. Moving these over, and then pretty much whether I want to or not, I'm gonna have to go in here and twirl these. So sad but true. Sometimes you know your fate and you just must accept it. Accept your fate, Neo. So I'm pressing and dragging on these. I'm making the handles much smaller, which is going to make them easier to blend between two shapes. Should soften it so that the edges don't have that harsh of a blend. See, I'm pulling these all out. It's doing the job. Now I'm going to go back and select them and move them to the left, screen left. And that should fix a lot of my problem. You know, the only thing I don't know is if I clicked on all these right. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, wasn't it? Okay. I accidentally got an edge here, so I'm going to do 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Why did I count my steps? There you go. Some of these anchor points I can just click on and move, and that's going to let the color out some more. Honestly. Drag this over to the left a little more. All right. Well, so this is the basic thing for you guys that I'm looking for you to complete. This is the meat and potatoes of this assignment. Now, from here forward, we're going to do a series of sort of rapid shapes. We're going to use bilateral symmetry, you know, both things being on the same side to be to our advantage. So the first thing I'm going to do is get the pen tool. The first thing I'm going to do is save. Then I'm going to get the pen tool and I'm going to create the ear. Do you remember? The ears are going to pretty much go from the bottom of the nose to the center of the eyebrows. So here you can see I'm creating the shape of the ear. And I want the ear to be the exact color where it joins the skin. So that's where I'm adding that color. Now, I'm just going to make up, I don't know, this is a made up character. So I'm just going to make up what I want inside the ear. I want a highlight on the top. I want the pad of the ear. I want an outer edge. So you can see I'm adding meshes here for these various things I'm describing, and down below and in here. So I just added a certain number of meshes. I could have really done that a lot of different ways. I'm going to grab the center parts of these meshes right here, you can see, and I'm going to use the eyedropper to pick up lighter colors here. I'm going to use that same lighter color. And then along the edges, I'm going to grab the edge anchor points here and give them the lighter color. And that'll see how that works. Just lightening that edge. I'm going to grab here and here and include those as well. There we go. I'm building up my edge. Yeah, I think I'm going down the edge here with the color that I've got. The lighter color, selecting all that using the eyedropper here and adding that in. You can see it's giving me a, you know, reasonable facsimile of an ear. It's ear-ish if it's not eerie. What did I just say? Now, the other thing I can do, I can get my tools and push around these handles a bunch. I'm kind of just moving slow here. I'm going to add some, I'm using the anchor point here to pick up the color I want. I'm not sure about that. It's important for me to remember that I can create more edgy kind of shapes by pulling down the color and pushing up the handles to create more of an edge. Kind of like I did there, although that's not really where I wanted the edge to be. But you can see I can grab these anchor points and sort of move them around, articulate the various portions and how I'd like them to look. Let me get this handle to lighten up a bit. There we go. Get it? Lighten up a bit. Okay. So that's the one ear, and I'm going to do the eye now. And you guys should remember the eye. We did the orbital of the eye. We made the outline of the eye. I'm going to go ahead and create the opening of an eye here. And this is the opening of the eye. This is not the eyelid. Actually, you know what? I'm going to make it the eyelid, eyelash, or eye, upper and lower eyelid. I'm going to pull that out a little bit further. I'm going to use the rotate tool here to kind of get it more where I wanted it. I'm going to move a couple of the anchor points around for better effect. Go. I want to spend the time here on this version so when I don't have to worry about it on the other side. So that's actually, this is the actual eye, upper and lower eyelid. So I'm going to draw the opening of the eye inside of that. I'm going to make the upper lid a little farther down than the lower lid. And you can see this is the opening of my eye. I'm going to try and articulate it a little better by moving the handles around. There we go. Okay, so it doesn't look any different. I can give it the default stroke and fill so it can be seen better. Now I'm getting the ellipse tool. I'm going to option, press and drag. Make sure the eye usually hangs underneath the upper lid. I'm going to add another anchor point here for the iris. I'm sorry, the pupil. And then I'm going to make a little highlight right next to that. There we go. So I'm going to go ahead and make my gradient. And I'm going to use, this is one of those times where I will use one of the swatches just to get started. So I have color. I'm going to click on the blue to transparent swatch. Once I have that, now I can hit radial and change the color. So here under radial, I'm going to take the opacity back up to 100, and I'm gonna make a green eyes this time. So this is the outer green color I'm making much darker. There we go. And then I'm double clicking on this one. This is gonna be the inner green color. And don't forget, I'm gonna use the halfway point to push the color closer to the edge. I'm going to select the iris with the black color over there. And I'm trying to get, here we go, no stroke. And then the highlight, same thing, no stroke. So I've got the three parts. I'm gonna select the three parts and use the object group command so they're easier to select. I'm gonna bring the outside of the eye to the front. I'm gonna hold down the shift key and select those things and choose object. Clipping mask, make, and there you have it. And I'm going to click on that now and use the use again the gradient a gradient swatch to add the color of the inside of the eye. I'm just going to start with that color. Here I'm going to make, this is the corner of the eye, it's going to be 40% magenta and 10% black. I'm going to do the same thing over here, 40 magenta, 10 of black, maybe more. And in the center, I'm going to, oh, this has got transparency. I need to give it 100% transparency. There we go. And then in the center, actually, I'm going to make two anchor points. The first one is going to be almost white, but it's going to be like 6% cyan and maybe 9% black. And make the same thing over here. Double click. whatever I can get it to say here. 7 is close enough. By 10-ish. And no magenta. There we go. And then I'm going to sort of push those closer in so that the opening of the eye doesn't look too messed up. The other thing I can do is rather than push the stops closer, I can push the gradient closer. So that gives it a little smoother look. So rather than push the stop, I'm going to push the halfway point closer. That pushes that little bit of red closer into the eyes. If I want to, I can always move the white closer as well. Now the opening of the eye, I'm going to bring that to the front momentarily. And I'm going to use the eyedropper to pick up the shadow color here. And then I'm going to get the gradient mesh tool and click in the center and then hit the eyedropper tool and pick up the highlight color. And that gives me the, let me see if I send it back here. Not bad. I lose it a little bit in the lower lid. I don't know if you can see. Yeah, you can see it pretty well. Now, and before I move on, I am going to do one more thing, which is I'm going to create a shadow for the inside of the eye. So I'm going to go over here and use the option key here. And I'm going to create a shadow color, the basic shadow color I'm using here. And I'm going to give it transparency. So, whoops, a little bit too far. Sort of pulling that back in. One more right here. Stop it. My problem is so often that you can't see it. Okay, so I'm going to use the eyedropper, pick up the shadow color. And then I'm going to go to transparency and I think, was it 30% or 20%? Maybe a little more than 20% in there. Gives me a little bit of a shadow in there that takes the color down a notch. I'm looking at it here. It's looking a little bit yellow. So I'm going to go in here and pull back the yellow a little bit so that it's not too cast yellow. I want it to be pretty neutral. All right, so I got my eye and my ear. I'm going to get the selection tool and I'm going to select all my made up parts here of both of those. And then I'm going to use the reflect tool and option click on the bridge of the nose. And that's, we've been doing this all semester long. I'm going to use not okay, but I hit copy and that flips it over to the other side. And as you guys pointed out before, that also caused an error in the eye, which is that the pupil or the highlight is on the wrong side. So I'm going to select that. And I like using the arrow keys. I'm just going to arrow key that sucker over to where it goes, which I think is right there. So there's my guy so far. I'm going to hit file save. I have some of the features on there. Thing to remember here is that my my features can change. You know, I can give one of the things that I think is going to be a good thing to do is to give your character a an expression. So that would be a combination of things like the it's giving me a hard time trying to select it here. I'm going to do it later. But you can see, I can move the eyes around. I can move them down like he's fearful or up like he's tired, side to side, whatever I want to do. So next thing I'm going to work on here, the last thing is hair. So I've already got the bridge of the eyes selected. So I'm going to create an eyebrow for each side. And I'm giving it a little bit of an edgy, a little contour to it. And as we remember from my first demonstration on the gradient mesh, it's like, that was brave of me to do this because I know that the more complicated the edge is in my Illustrator outlines, the more wonky the gradient mesh inside is going to be. So I am sort of working carefully here not to make this too complicated. And I am going to use my rotate tool, sit in the origin point, just to move that up a little bit. There we go. So that's my hair color. I'm going to go, I don't know. I guess I'm going to use these same colors for the hair. I'm just going to change it. So I'm going to make the hair like a sandy blonde color, I guess. Should be able to see that. Where is it? Hey, what's going on here? I should see that mix right here. I'm not sure why. Huh. What's going on here? Did I do something wrong? Well, I'm going to click on this and use my eyedropper and select it. I'm going to double click on that. I don't know what's going on. I'm checking, I just drew that shape. I should be able to do all kinds of things to it. But for some reason, when I'm clicking on it, it's great. It's not allowing me to mix the color. Let me try. Okay, there it is. I don't know why. I'm going to go add a little black onto this. And I'm going to establish this as the darker color. I'm going to use my eyedropper. Hopefully that, okay. So this being the hair, I am going to use the gradient mesh on this. I've got the darker part of the color. I'm just going to click once and see if I'm lucky. I'm going to use the shift key to pull this color way back. This is my sandy blonde, sandy brown color hair I'm shooting for here. So we're pulling these back. So when I look at what it did, it kind of gave me some serendipitous curve here that's sort of not too bad looking. I am, as you can see, trying to rearticulate that in a better way. So I'm going in here and pulling some of these handles in to get it to quit pushing the edge quite so much. The other thing I want to do is get the edges to not quite push so far also. So if I click on one of these anchors, I'm not sure why it's not where those are coming from. So I'm clicking on these anchor points. I'm trying to let that sandy color go further in. But as you can see, I don't really have an anchor point on the side. So my choice is I've got that selected. I can add another anchor point, say like right here. And interesting, use my eyedropper, pick up the lighter color there. So that's helping me with the lighter color. I'm gonna click on this one here and add it. And I could even go further out here. I'm gonna get my meshes here. There we go. Got a gradient mesh there and easy eyedropper and pick up the color here. So that pushes that color further back into my color palette. So I am going to pick up that color here so that I can use it again. And I am going to use the reflect tool to reflect this across the bridge of the nose and use copy just like I did with the other ones. And I might even, you know, use the rotate tool and give one side a slightly different angle. You may want to rotate it quite so much. So I'm just going to pull this out. I'm also thinking they both need to be much closer down. If you look at the way my eyebrows are shaded, or where the bridge of my eyes are shaded, these should really be further down. So if they're up here like this, I'm going to hide them for the moment. I think these anchor points right here that I just selected, I'm going to use the eyedropper and bring that shadow color up a little bit higher. I think it was showing too much. I'm going to use anchor points here in the center. Oops, not there, but here and here. bring that shadow color into the bridge of the nose. And now when I bring back my slices of bacon, clearly, you can see for eyes that they get in there. So for the hair, you know, there's a lot of things you can do with the hair. But again, you're going to want to sort of break it into a couple of pieces is going to be the easiest thing to do. I'm going to you know, try a little bit of risky curvature here in the side of my character's head. I'm going to go slightly outside the cranium. Oh, you know, let me finish drawing this, but my smart guides are driving me nuts. I hate the smart guides. It's command U. I keep accidentally clicking on that. So here we go. Just gonna pick that up. I'm going to hide this for a second. One thing I forgot to tell you is when you get to this point, you're still working with an egg and the egg is just meh looking at. So one of the things you can do, I'm going to do it on this one, is I can grab the whole bottom of the chin here. Like I just did. I did pretty much. And I'm going to use the scale tool and I can give more of a pointed chin by using the scale tool. It also very much depends on how you select what you select. I'm going to get the direct selection tool and select really the entire bottom of the face and try that same move again. And you can see that I'm having a little bit of trouble with. Reminds me of one of those filters in TikTok. You know, you can mess up your face. Okay, so I can make further changes there if I want to. Another thing I can do is grab the top part and make the top part of the head a little more square. Shoot, starts looking like me. If I gave him a sideburn hair job, it would look like me. So, you know, I am going to actually grab parts of the chin here as best I can. And looks like I need to grab at least all of this. Yikes. Do you believe what I'm looking at? I mean, I'm looking at this going, okay, what do I grab to move? So I think what I want is to do like this. I think is what I actually want. That's what I want. So I've got all that selected. I'm going to use the scale tool and just see if I can get it to pull in. You can see I'm having a lot of trouble with the corners there. All right, I got that in. Now I'm going to use the arrow keys and pull that down a little bit. Now I can go in a little bit further. There we go. Now I got what I was looking for. And I had to kind of do it in a couple of different moves. So remember that. Oh, no, wait, I'm going for it. So this is going to be semi-autobiographical, people. Be careful. So here we go. And yeah, I did have enormous sideburns when I was younger in my 20s. This is the banker. This is the guy at the bank who's checking you out for a loan. There we go. So I did the one side here. I'm going to click on that. And that's going to be my shadow color. Click on the highlight. Go with the gradient meshes here. I'm going to establish color first and then go for contours afterwards. You know, I could also just click on these anchor points and end up moving them. Maybe that's just enough. And if I do a bald dude like this, of course I can easily just flip this over to the other side. Boy, they don't call them lamb chops for nothing, do they? And copy that to the other side. That looks really terrible to me. I can't stand that. That's not going to fly. So I'm going to delete that and go with a more traditional haircut here. So I am going to create it in probably three pieces is probably the best way to do this. I'm going to kind of try and give them some contour in the top, coming around back to the back. And eyedropper here. Now pen tool again. Be sure that I'm, doing most of this stuff, grabbing the pen tool and whatnot. I'm doing most of that stuff through key commands. So if you were ever like, well, how did you get the tool here? Well, it's right under where, if you were to select the tool, it would be right there where it says, the name of the tool. It also says the shortcut to use it. I'm going to try copying this over to the other side, see if it gives me enough of what I'm looking for or too much. Yeah. So I'm going to bring this to the front. And then I'm going to manipulate this a little bit just so it doesn't look like there's too much bilateral symmetry. I'm going to pull it sort of up into here. And okay. So here, because the contour is a little more complicated, I'm expecting, I think I'm going to go ahead. Let's go ahead and mesh these. I've got three objects selected. None of them are gradient meshes, and I'm going to do create gradient mesh. And I'm going to give them 5x5s. Yeah, I'm going to give them 5x5s. And you can see that creates just the standard meshes. So I'm using both techniques here. And this allows me to not divide things up so carefully. The only problem here is you can see that in this sideburn area, it really added too many verticals. So I'm actually going to undo that whole thing. But now that I've seen it and I kind of know how it laid out, I'm going to actually try and kind of copy some of that. But I'm just going to do it much more sparsely. I want to preserve some shadow on the edges. I want there to be highlights. So I'm trying to create opportunities for both of those things to happen. Actually, this is a 3x3 mesh. But it's not symmetrical. And that's the problem with the add gradient mesh tool is that, pull down menu, is that it just adds, divides up the shape and adds them, adds the meshes equal. There's no you get this mesh over here, you get this mesh over there. So in here, I'm just trying to give myself the controls that I need. I'm going to do the same thing over here and add some more to it. There we go. All right. I'm ready to add color now. So I'm going to go in here and just sort of start, my direct selection tool, just start and just add the color. It's going to create mostly like a stripe here. Use the eyedropper and hit the median skin tone color here. And I don't really like that color, so I'm picking a part of its shadow. Oops, let me try that again. Bang. And then I'm going to pick a part of its shadow. There we go. For the highlight color, I'm going to go along the back here, picking up that same highlight color. All these meshes. Oops. I'm selecting and giving that color to the edges, some of these edges as well. I'm selecting using my eyedropper to pick up that color. And this will give me some trouble right here. I want this to make sure that this matches. I'm going to lock that to keep selecting it. And here I'm just grabbing this edge. And then I'm going to use the eyedropper so that it matches that edge pretty well. Same thing here. I want it to look pretty blended. I can always move these things around later like that. But I want to make sure whatever's selected pretty much matches what it's next to. Up here, I'm clicking up here now in this broad area. It's important to remember you can click, you can select a gradient from a quadrant as well as a area. I'm gonna have to hide that and use this anchor point to pick up these colors. Yeah, there's my bald dude. All right, so now I'm going all along these anchor points here. I'm gonna figure out what I like where. Oops, not quite that. So you can see I'm sort of creating some variable, tonal aspects into this. I'm trying to get it to look a little bumpy, little curly-ish, wavy. I don't know. How do you call it? So as you can see here, pretty much closing up on my shape, just sort of picking what looks good where is really, I don't have a much better way of saying it that this is, fairly much by choice the way I'm colorizing this. So that's basically that. I mean, if we compare this to the one I did on Monday, the couple of things I did that I didn't do with this one is I did just like press and drag and then send this to the back, use all one color and then transparency to create like a drop shadow. Said drop shadow. That's like 20%. So I can take my gradient mesh and add some shadows to it. I'm going to do the same thing here and send it. Oops. Do the same thing here and send it to the back. Use my eyedropper. Get my shadow color. Same thing over here. I'm going to drag this one, drag it down a little bit. Send it to the back, pick up that color and give it the shadow color. And then I think I went even further and I made the rugged beard type. So that's also going to add to my contours. I'm going to go ahead and just create it over top of what's here. Continue on up side of the face, joining into the previous outline. Snap two is really messing with me, but here I go, going around the end of the chin here. I'm creating a common line. I always say don't do that, but here I'm just kind of doing it real quick to prove my point. I would need to go back in there and correct this. Even I am not accurate enough to get this perfectly every time, but it's going to get me through this lecture. There we go. Now, the mouth area, remember, I have this option of creating a compound path. So here I'm making the inside of the beard where there's a mouth comes out. And I'm going to use a compound path to control that. So I've got that shape and this shape. And do object, compound path, make. And that creates an opening. And then I'm going to add my 20% transparency. And actually, I think in this case, I went with less, even 15%. Now, one of the things you got to watch out for using transparency is the transparency over a transparency is visible. So one of the things that I might be able to do, although I've never tried it, got a very complicated shape here. I've got a compound path and these are gradient meshes. What do you think the Pathfinder is going to do with all that if I hit unite? Anybody want to guess? I am not sure it's going to do it because of the gradient meshes, but let's give it a try. If I hit unite, as I suspected, it did nothing. So yeah, I was hoping I could unite them and that would get rid of that little crossover where my sideburns are crashing into the beard shadow. So the other option, of course, is just to grab all those anchor points and move them so that they are not doing that, which is something that I prefer not to have done. But you can see I can, you know, basically move these anchor points around and eventually get it to the point where that's not overlapping. You know, to finish this out the way I had asked is to go ahead and you know, finish out the neck. I am going to create a neck here, and you know, super simple at this point. I'm going to underlap it. I'm going to send it to the back. I'm going to use the eyedropper and pick up the median skin color. You guys know the drill. I'm going to add gradient meshes. I'm going to bring it to the front. I'm going to add gradient meshes to create an under chin shadow. And a couple of side shadows out here. So that means what I'm going to do is I'm going to grab all these exterior anchor points here. And on this side and down below, and I'm going to use my eyedropper and pick up my shadow color there. See, this one probably needs it. There we go. And then below, there's a shadow here. Now, if I send it to the back, use my anchor point tool to move that shadow down. And I can even use this one, move it down, giving me sort of a Adam's apple affair there. And grab these two, move them up higher to even emphasize that. And I probably need one more mesh here is what I'm thinking. I'm going to add one more gradient mesh here above right there. I'm going to select the other side and get the eyedropper tool to pick up the shadow there, shadow here. And I think that might look okay. Yeah, you can't really select something through another object. So for me to do what I'm trying to do here, I have to bring it to the front. And what I'm trying to do is just pull the shadows that are under the chin down a little bit further so that we can see the shadows under the chin. Grab these guys here, pull them down as well. Made my shadow a little bit harsh on the edge, so I'm gonna pull that down. I'm pretty sure these sides are giving me trouble too. So I'm going to grab this anchor point and this one and pull them down. It's a cascade effect. You can see that one thing creates a problem with the next thing. So here, I've got to zoom in and figure out what's going on here. So this handle, I see, is way up here. I lied. This handle is way down here. Here it is. It's this one that needs to come. Whoops, I lied. It's this one that needs to come down. There we go. Okay, I think I've got it all sorted. I'm changing these handles a little bit. Like I said, the more it looks like a gradient mesh, probably the more accurate it is. These shadows are too dark. I'm using the eyedropper tool to lighten those up a bit. And this is maybe a little too hot. This a little too severe. Using my handles to pull those handles apart so that they blend more smoothly, less severely. There we go. Those handles are hard to see. And the only thing, my big thing to Adobe is I wish you would make it so that you, when you zoom in, the anchor points get bigger to some degree, because that's really hard to see. Okay, so there's the neck. That's that was pretty hard. Wasn't too hard. And here I'm going to go ahead and finish out my character. I'm going to just put this back here, send it to the back. Move this one down a bit. Use my arrow key. little curve. Actually, I need an anchor point here. I'm using the handles to move that up and in. And I'm gonna use a color here. I'm gonna pick sort of a red color for the shirt. And then the background, just to wrap it all up. Actually, I think I'm gonna go for that. I think I'll take another look at that gradient. Yeah, there we go. Maybe this one needs to be 100%. It's gonna be darker. Go with the radial. And then I'm gonna put the gradient offset. There we go. Time. Well, I've slowed down over the week. I think I was getting done quicker than this. I'm not done. Some of the things that I would like to continue doing is I'm going to use the gradient mesh tool here and click on the cheeks. And then under the cheeks, I'm going to use the eyedropper and, you know, can add some highlights on the cheeks if I want to. And it usually helps. I mean, should I? Yeah, it usually looks better if I do. It's a little bit frustrating to do these for you in class, because I'm always like, hey, yeah, I keep going from here. But, you know, I get to a certain point where I'm like, I know you guys are saturated. You've seen enough. You've seen this, you know, what I'm doing. And there's a video and you're going to look at that if you need it. But I do want you guys to just get in there, be fearless. Give this technique a try. Try and get some control over the areas of shadow on the background. Don't forget, you can watch the video and do it step by step. I mean, you could step by step follow everything I do and get the, you know, basic idea of how this is working.